Hello, welcome to my channel. I'm All Things Wrestling. Today I'm going to be giving my comments, opinions and the results of WWE Hell in a Cell 2016. Straight off the bat, this is the greatest Hell in a Cell pay-per-view of all time. It was amazing. In this video, I'm going to be giving match ratings to all the matches and I'm going to be doing it for every pay-per-view video from here on out. Anyway, we start with the pre-show and we see Brian Kendrick find TJ Perkins in his locker room and he says he's not sure whether he's decided about laying down for him tonight, but it means a lot to him. Perkins said they represent the entire division and there's plenty of kids out there right now who want to be them one day. Kendrick says he was thinking about their friendship and how it could be just like old times when Kendrick was helping him out and he had nothing. Perkins said he'll always be his friend and Kendrick says he needs the title. Kendrick reaches for the belt and Perkins tells him to go out there and be the Brian Kendrick he used to know and win it the right way. Kendrick says he needs Perkins to let him win and he walks off. Then we start with the only match on the pre-show. Sin Cara, Lince Dorito and Cedric Alexander versus Drew Gulak, Tony Nese and Daivari. Unfortunately, this is the only match I did not watch live because I thought the pre-show started at 12 but it started at 11. So I actually missed the match. The finish happened when Cedric hit a top rope clothesline on Nese and then hit the lumbar check on Gulak for the win. That's one prediction I've got right so far. Then we go straight to the main show and it kicks off with the United States Championship Hell in a Cell match, Rusev versus Roman Reigns. It was an absolutely amazing match. The ending was amazing. Rusev had Roman Reigns in an accolade on top of a set of steel steps in the ring with a chain in his mouth. It was absolutely amazing. Roman managed to get out of it and then Rusev was standing on top of the steel steps in the ring and Roman hit him with a spear. Roman retained the belt. That's two predictions I got right and this match I give a 7.5 out of 10. It was a great match. Great way to blow off their feud. I'd just like to see which direction both men go off in. Then we go to Bayley versus Dana Brooke. The match was alright. Dana showed a lot of potential targeting the injured shoulder. Bayley did wrestling. Bayley hit the belly to belly for the win. That's the third prediction I got right. And I give the match a 5 out of 10. It was just a bit... No one seemed interested. I wasn't interested. At least Bayley won. That's the main thing. Then we go backstage to Mick Foley and Seth McMahon talking about how great this pay-per-view is going to be and how much better it will be next month when they go head-to-head with SmackDown Live. Chris Jericho walks in and says that they have to think... Okay, I did it wrong. Then we go backstage to Mick Foley and Stephanie McMahon talking about how great this pay-per-view is going to be and how much better it will be next month when they go head-to-head with SmackDown Live. Chris Jericho walks in and says that they should think hard about who they want to put on Team Raw. Foley asks Jericho if he has a point and Jericho asks Foley if he knows what happens to people who interrupt him. He says Stephanie should choose wisely and he thinks the first choice should be him and the second choice should be his best friend Kevin Owens. A team will only be good as its leaders. And Team Chris and Kevin should be co-captains of Team Raw. Foley tells Jericho that he should make sure that his best friend makes out of Hell in a Cell with the title. Jericho puts Foley's name on the list, but he doesn't actually say, you're on the list. Because he's on the list like 5 times, so it kind of seems irrelevant. It weren't a bad segment. I guess it had to make an appearance somewhere. Luckily it was only this once. Then we go to Enzo Amore and Big Cass versus Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson. It was an alright match. Their promo stuff at the beginning was alright and he says that he's going to have to call Big Cass Woody because he's going to have the name Andy tattooed on the bottom of his boot referring to Anderson. I don't know. I didn't really pay attention to the promo. The win happened when Gallows hit a big super kick to Enzo and then the magic killer for the win. I give the match a 6 out of 10. And the first thing I actually got wrong tonight. It was nice to see the club get a win. They really needed it. I was hoping that I would be wrong on this one. Hopefully they can try and get back in the title race once the New Day beat Demolition's record. Oh, sorry, spoilers there. Let's continue anyway. You knew they were going to retain. Then we have the WWE Universal Championship Hell in a Cell match. Oh my god, this match was match of the night. It was incredible. Let's start with one of my favourite spots from the thing. Kevin Owens set a table from the ring apron up to the set, up to the saddle, past the third rope, making it a triangle thing, and table underneath it. Seth Rollins gets him up for a powerbomb, kind of drops him a little bit, and then gets him back up and powerbombs him through both tables. It was the greatest spot I've seen in a long time. Chris Jericho did manage to get in the cage. The spot was awesome as well. Kevin Owens got a fire extinguisher out, if you remember them in wrestling. Accidentally sprayed the referee in the eyes. They took him out. Chris Jericho got in, locked himself in the cell and kept the key. Shenanigans happened, and it was amazing. And then the finish happened when Seth Rollins got powerbombed through two chairs. It was amazing. I gave this match a 9 out of 10. It was incredible. And then Jericho hit a co-breaker to Rollins just for the heck of it at the end of the match. It was amazing. I cannot praise this match enough. The both men looked like absolute superstars in there. Absolute wrestling legends. Whew. And I got my prediction right off the Kevin Owens match. He won, which makes it my fourth right prediction out of five at the minute. Then we go to the WWE Cruiserweight Championship match, TJ Perkins versus Brian Kendrick. The match was really, really good. I wasn't expecting too much out of it, but it's probably their best match ever. The finish happened. Brian did slice bread and fell on his knee and did an injury. Remember, like Shawn Michaels back in 08, he faked an injury. TJ checked on him after the referee stopped him a couple of times. He headbutted him, put him in the captain's hook / bully choke, whatever you want to call it, and he tapped out. And Brian Kendrick won the championship. The finish was amazing. It's so 2008. I love it. I gave the match 7.5 out of 10, and that is another prediction. That would be 5 out of 6 at the minute. Then we go backstage to where Cesaro and Sheamus are talking about how great they are and all that kind of stuff, and how they can walk out the WWE tag team titles. They talk about how they couldn't stand each other and how much time they wasted. Then they were arguing out who's going to follow whose lead. They wind up in a full-blown argument. Then we go to the New Day versus Cesaro and Sheamus. This was the worst match on the card, in my opinion. I gave it a 4 out of 10. The finish happened. Cesaro had Xavier Woods in the sharpshooter. And just before he tapped, Kofi, who was not a legal man, not legal in the match, hit a Trouble in Paradise on Sheamus, and the referee called for the disqualification, and then just as Xavier started to tap. So Sheamus and Cesaro thought they won, but they got the win by disqualification. I guess that's a way to prolong it, but the overall match was a bit, I'm going to be honest, I wasn't really into it. It just weren't anything good, which is a shame because it's the New Day. Then we go to the women's Hell in the Cell match, which closes the show. History is being made here. This match, again, was absolutely fantastic. Just fell short of the match of the night, in my opinion. I just think the Rollins-Owens match was slightly better. We start with Charlotte dumping Sasha out of the ring before the cell even fully came down. Charlotte climbs a cell, then Sasha climbs a cell. They fight. Charlotte falls to the floor. Charlotte powerbombs Sasha through the table. One referee asks for an EMT to come out. Charlotte goes in the ring, demands to give her a title as they're putting a neck brace on Sasha. They load onto a stretcher, and the referee comes in the ring and is about to award Charlotte the title, saying Sasha forfeits because they never actually started the match. When Sasha gets off the stretcher from hearing the announcements, fights away into the cell, and they actually start the match, which was a bit of a controversial start, but they got me. I'm going to be honest, I was getting really annoyed saying, why are we doing this, why are we doing that, and then they did this. They swerved me, and it was amazing. The finish, they brought a table in, and I think Charlotte was meant to go through it, but she never actually went through the table. I don't know, it didn't break. which was a bit boo. The match was great, I'm going to be honest. It was seeing Sasha go through what they were doing in that thing of bloody tables and going to the cell constantly. It was amazing. The finish happened when Charlotte ragdolled Sasha on top of the table that was near the corner after she brought one in twice, and then Charlotte hit natural selection for the win. So Charlotte is your new women's champion. So I got the Sasha Charlotte prediction wrong, and we end up with a total of 6 right and 8 wrong, which I don't think is too bad. I don't get this decision. I mean, the match was great and all, but why would you keep giving it to Sasha just for her to lose it at the next pay-per-view? This is twice you've done this, WWE. I'm not going to get invested in Sasha Banks if you're just going to keep screwing her over. Is this a way for Bayley to get in and take the title? I don't know. But for the love of God, I don't know what you're doing. I mean, it didn't ruin the night or anything like that. I'm happy that Charlotte's won it back. She's a fantastic wrestler, but I'm just kind of trying to figure out your booking decision here, WWE. It's the one thing I really have to pick at this pay-per-view for. But the actual card was absolutely well-structured. It was only 3 hours and 20 minutes of a pay-per-view, which wasn't too short or too long. It was about right. They've managed to split the selling the matches from first, middle and end, which was amazing. So people didn't get bored of it straight away. Everyone seemed to be invested in all 3 matches, which was good because that's what I was worried about, cell overload. But overall, this was the best Hell in the Cell ever. Best Hell in the Cell pay-per-view ever. It was phenomenal. And I can't wait to see what Survivor Series does, really. They can only go up from here, I'm hoping. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll catch you later.